Ciao tutti, bentornati o benvenuti a TM1 Nybbles Technology Information in under 16 minutes. Today's episode continues and concludes this sub-series about environment variables in Windows. In the first episode, we looked at what environment variables are in general. In the second one, we looked at one of the most important ones, specifically the path environment variable. In this episode, we look at another important environment variable, the app data one, and to a lesser extent, the program data one, and also at the folders that underlie them. Your 16 minutes starts now. Programs often need a place to store working data and in some cases program configuration data such as option settings. In some cases the latter can be stored in the Windows registry, which you may recall me describing as the computer's database about itself and its software. But that does have the disadvantage that if you use a different computer, your configuration settings will not be there on the second computer. Another place where such settings can be stored, along with working files that can't be stored in the registry, is a special directory that each user has called the app data or application data directory. You do need to be aware of this directory whether you're a TM1 user or not, for the reasons that are more fully detailed in the Windows Hints and Tips subseries that follows this one. The reason that TM1 users may need to know about it is detailed later in this episode. Before we go there though, I want to talk about another folder, the program data folder. This relates to configuration settings and working data that relate to all user accounts on the machine. By default, this folder sits directly on the C drive and it is hidden, but you can expose it by going to the View menu and turning on Hidden Items, and we can see that there it is there. The other way of getting to it is directly through the environment variable, which is program data with no spaces naturally. You may recall that the percentage signs are used as an expansion command. They will turn the name of the environment variable into the contents of the environment variable, which in this case is the path to the program data folder. When I press enter, there we are. Now for once, Microsoft isn't just screwing around with you. These folders are hidden for a reason, because if you don't know what you're doing and you just treat them as a normal folder, you can break things. But if you follow the old NASA axiom of if you don't know what to do, don't do anything, then you'll be fine. And of course the intent of this series is that if you watched enough episodes, you'll confidently know what to do anyway. Nonetheless, generally I do recommend that you leave this one alone unless you run into the kind of problems that I'll discuss more in the next sub-series. Now, the main reason that I'm mentioning this at the moment is that some people overlook this folder when they're moving to a new machine, and some programs may have critical data in there. An example of this is Camtasia Studio, which is the program that I'm using to record this series, for now. But that's a different discussion. Its assets library is stored in program data, and if you don't remember to export it before you move to the new machine, or if you don't at least copy the program data directory off your old machine, you can end up with a bunch of video productions which have broken links all over the place. And I'm sure that Camtasia is not the only program in that boat. But now it is time for us to turn our attention to the application data directory folder. Where exactly is it? Windows stores all user data in a folder which is normally on the C drive called Users, so you can see that down there. Each user on a Windows system has their own folder within that one. So for example, Andre Gomez's account would typically be something like C Users A Gomez. The name will in fact vary depending on the type of account used. If it's a Microsoft account, it may be something like Andre G1. The name doesn't matter as long as it uniquely identifies the user on that machine. Now just for reference, you don't need to know this, but I'll tell you anyway, Microsoft calls the combination of the predefined folders that sit under the user folder and the related entries relating to the user in the Windows registry, the user profile. This is the user account that I'm using to record these videos. One of the folders in here is called app data, but of course you can't see it. Why? Naturally enough, it's a hidden folder. You can go to the view menu, turn it back on, so hidden items, and now you can see app data. Needless to say, you can also go through the environment variable, which is of course app data, sort of. Again, remember that there are no spaces there. But you should be aware that this will not in fact take you to the app data folder itself, but rather to one of the three that are underneath it. Specifically, it points to the roaming subdirectory, as you can see here, which is the most important of the three. Now, it is called roaming because it can be synchronized on a network, thus allowing a user's settings to follow them, or roam if you prefer, if they log on to different computers on the same network. The reason that it's the most important of the three is that the vast majority of applications just dump their working data in there, probably because of the way the app data environment variable points straight to it anyway. I'm going to move up one level, and we'll see that the three folders are there. The second one that we're going to look at is this one, the local application data folder. This, in fact, also has its own environment variable, which is local app data. So you see that if I type that, surrounded by the expansion signs, enter, we go straight into the local folder. I'll just move back up one level again, and the third one that we can see here is local low, which does not seem to have an environment variable. So why the differences between these three? Well, as I said, the intention was to use the roaming folder to allow application data to follow the user when they log on to different machines on a network. This is probably a less common requirement these days, with increasing number of workplaces having migrated to everyone having their personal notebooks and hot desking, but not all workplaces are like that, and it still may be useful. One of the issues with roaming is that it would take time to synchronize between the machines when a user logs onto a new machine for the first time. And the local app data folder was intended to hold files which were too large to roam, or computer settings that are so specific to the current machine that roaming is pointless. One Microsoft document that I read, which dated back to the Vista era when this methodology was first used, raised the specter of some roaming app data folders being over 20 megs in size. Can you imagine? Now, as we shall see in the next series, roaming app data folders can run to gigabytes without breaking a sweat, especially if you have the assistance of Adobe Creative Cloud, but there are other offenders as well. Now, this is not to say that large files won't get stored in local folder. If you check the size of the local folder, you'll probably find that quite often that runs to gigabytes as well, especially if you are a heavy user of Google Chrome, which for some reason stores all of its data in the local folder. If you want to know where the bulk of your local app data disk space is going to, it'll probably be split between the Google and Microsoft folders. The third folder that I referred to, local low, is sort of the orphan of the group. This is intended to quarantine data that may not be trusted. The low refers to low integrity applications which run with restricted security access and cannot write to the standard folders. It may come as no surprise to you that there was one particular piece of software that Microsoft had in mind when they created this folder in Internet Explorer. I'm looking at you. However, there are other applications that will write data in there as well, including the Java installation programs, if you have Java installed, because really, security-wise, pretty much nobody trusts Java anyway, useful as I grudgingly admit it can be at times. Now, I want to briefly talk about the subject of redirection, something that I've found to be particularly useful. One of the ways that Microsoft worked around the size issue for the roaming app data directory was to allow it to be redirected. For example, you could redirect it to a network location, which would mean that regardless of the computer that you're on, as long as you are logged into the network, all of your roaming app data files would be instantly available, or at least instantly in terms of the bandwidth of your network. Of course, if the network itself is down or you're remote from the office and on a slow connection, you're screwed, but apart from that, it is actually a good idea. Still, the concept of redirection can be useful even if you're running an unnetworked PC, or at least one that's not on a Windows domain, I should say. A lot of PCs these days, and this includes notebooks, are moving to solid-state disks, or SSDs, which are fast, but they are not cheap on a per-gigabyte basis. They therefore aren't normally that large in absolute capacity, since the really large ones cost a bomb. To get around this, a lot of PCs, including the very one that you are watching this recording on, have gone for a hybrid approach. So they have an SSD drive. So if we take a look at Western Digital's SSDs, and then we take a look at their hard disk drives, you can see that, for example, the WD Blue 3D comes in capacities of 250 gig, 500 gig, 1 terabyte, 2 terabytes, starting at $88.99, but you're sure as heck not going to be paying that for a 2 terabyte one, let me tell you. On the other hand, the mechanical hard disk drives over here, 500 gigabytes to 6 terabytes, starting at $65.99. So this machine, I have a 500 gigabyte SSD and I have a 4 terabyte mechanical drive because I need that for video production. Now, if you know that your roaming application data directory will bloat, and if you're using Adobe Creative Cloud extensively, you can take that probability to the bank. What you can do is what I've done on this machine and redirect the folder to the mechanical drive from the SSD, so you're not chewing up your precious, fast, high-cost SSD space, you're instead repointing it to the mechanical disk where you have plenty of room. The way you can do that is by right-clicking on the folder and going to Properties, and then going to the location. You can see here that I have repointed this from the C drive to the D drive. A couple of words of caution about this. You can only do this for the subfolders in AppData, not the AppData folder itself. So if we go back up to the root AppData folder, right click on that, go to properties, you will see that you don't have the option to change the location. There are only specific folders, including the subfolders within AppData, that you can do this for. Now in Windows 7, it used to be easy to move the whole user folder over to the mechanical drive, and indeed that's what I ran with on Windows 7 for 5 years. And I did it without a problem. Try it in Windows 10 and you'll screw up the updates. You will not realize this until things go badly wrong and you no longer have a functioning Windows 10 system. Instead, you can redirect the individual folders. So that's all of the AppData folders, folders like My Documents, My Photos, and so on and so forth. They're not called My anymore, that's actually XP Talk. But all of those individual folders you can actually redirect. Now when you do so, Windows will ask you if you want to move everything that is in the folder, and always say no. Leave the old folder in place. On my personal login on this machine, which this is not, I moved everything without a problem. On this login, the notification and taskbars became non-functional twice, and when I did a bit of research, I found that this is a known issue. And each time I had to kill the login and recreate it. Once I said no, don't move everything, just create the new folders and point to that new location, then it was fine. Actually, I think I copied over the folders from the existing location, copied, not moved, and then repointed everything. But given the amount of space that roaming can take up, and actually even local can take up if you're using Chrome, then it's certainly a worthwhile thing to do. That is, if you are in that situation of having a smaller SSD and a much higher capacity hard disk drive, an old mechanical hard disk drive, which, as I said, you will also find in a lot of high-performance notebooks these days. Now, didn't I say something about TM1 users needing to be aware of these folders as well? Indeed, I did. But, of course, they are Windows users and need to know it for that reason, but there is a more specific reason. And that is, if you go to AppData, that is roaming AppData, but we shall just use the shortcut, you will see that there is a folder named Applix, assuming that you have the classic TM1 client installed, this is. And by that I mean Perspectives and Architect, not the newer Cafe, Pax, or Paw. So you will find a folder called Applix, within which there is a folder called TM1, within which there are at least 3 files, possibly 4. One is the tm1p.ini file, which is the configuration file for TM1 client. You should generally leave that alone and modify it only from your options dialog, but if you have real problems with your configuration, you can blow it away and start again. Note that most importantly, you will probably need to reset your admin host through the options dialog, but that is a subject for a different time. However, if you have a problem with the subset editor crashing, it is sometimes the result of a corrupted TBD file. You see that we have one TBD file here, which is subed.tbd. Sometimes you will find dimed.tbd as well. If you have regular crashes in your subset editor, you can try blowing away both of the TBD files and see if that helps. It's completely safe to do that. They'll just regenerate the next time you use the subset editor. Now this should actually be a rarity now, cross fingers, knock on wood, etc. I found that it was an issue in a lot of pre-9.5 versions, but I have to admit I haven't encountered it very often since at least we moved to 9.5. Nonetheless, keep it in the back of your mind that this folder is here and keep in mind what it contains. Now finally, for the sake of completeness, I'll mention that there is also a public user folder, which we can see here under Users Public. Now that can contain shared documents, but it does not have an AppData folder. It's only intended to share actual document files, pictures, music files, and so on. As I said earlier, config data and files which are shared between the machine's various users are more likely to be in the program data directory. So there you have it, a reasonably detailed if fast-paced overview of the AppData directory and its environment variables, and that concludes this sub-series. Next week we begin another 3-part sub-series on general Windows hints and tips, concentrating mainly on Windows 10, but with some relevance to those who are still on Windows 7. And if you're on Windows 8, then if you can't care enough about yourself to get off that version, then I can't care about you either. Just kidding, you may be a victim of circumstance, I realise, but no, I won't be doing any Windows 8 videos. Like Vista and Windows ME, it's a version that we should pretend never actually happened. If you got something out of this video, then please whack the like button over the head, subscribe if you would care to do so, and comment if you would care to do so, so that YouTube knows that these videos actually exist, and so that it and I know that you want more of them. But for now, your time is done. So until next time, goodbye.